In the video today, we are answering a viewer question because Mandy R. asks us, in movies, they always act like it's important for a person to stay conscious when they've been seriously injured. Does that really help someone live? And just before we get started with this question, we'd like to give a shout out to a longtime writer for this channel, and he's also a paramedic, by the way. His name is Scott, and besides writing the script for this very video, he also happens to co-host a hilarious podcast called Medical Confessions. If you like in-depth coverage of various medical topics done in a humorous way, and you clicked on this video, so you probably do, or you just want to see an otherwise extremely intelligent person sit in a barrel of ice for an hour while he podcasts on the effects of hypothermia just so you can witness them firsthand, please do go check out the Medical Confessions podcast and YouTube channel linked below. Let's get into it, shall we? So we've all seen movie scenes where someone is seriously injured and slowly drifting in and out of consciousness. Someone else there will inevitably say something along the lines of, "Stay with me, damn it!" It's even sometimes explicitly stated that it's important for the person to stay awake to keep the Grim Reaper away. Towards this end, the person with them may even be shown to slap the person in the face and or shake them in order to keep them conscious. So this brings us to the question of the hour. Will staying conscious provide any benefit to someone who is seriously injured, as depicted in almost every Hollywood movie ever? And the answer in short is, well, no, not really. In fact, unconsciousness may even mildly help them in some cases. For example, one study, Tightly Coupled Brain Activity and Cerebral ATP Metabolic Rate, published in Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences USA, showed when rats were intentionally knocked out, they produced about 50% fewer ATP molecules, ATP being the energy that cells use to perform all their vital functions. The net result of all of this was about a 66% reduction in energy requirements by the brain, potentially a very good thing if your body is already low on the necessary resources to, you know, keep on keeping on. That said, there is one caveat here. Being awake while you're potentially succumbing to your demise can be very helpful for a medical provider in some cases. Namely, if it's not obvious what's wrong with you, you being able to communicate the cause of your situation, the specifics of the pain you're in, or any pertinent history of the problem will help them more easily figure out the best way to treat you as rapidly as possible, which may make all the difference. However, other than those benefits, when it comes to staying alive, being conscious isn't a requirement in any way. Further, your level of consciousness and any change in it actually guides how an emergency provider will treat you via the Glasgow Coma Scale. First published by neurosurgery professors Graham Teasdale and Brian Jennett in 1974 from the University of Glasgow, the scale is used to describe how impaired someone's consciousness actually is. It assesses a patient according to three general criteria. 4 parts for eye-opening, 5 parts for verbal response, and 6 parts for motor response. As an example, there's the commonly known phrase in emergency medicine, AGCS less than 8, intubate. This basically means if you score less than 8, your chance of maintaining your own airway for breathing is so low that it is recommended, and generally an extremely good idea, to stick a tube into the patient's trachea and take over breathing for them. Should someone have a score of 14, confused, but otherwise normal, then all of a sudden have a score of 9, the level at which Hollywood would have you slapping them incessantly, this would indicate a significant thing just happened, and the provider would need to reevaluate the treatment strategy and confirm or disprove what they think is going on. Now, understanding the vast number of things that can cause someone to become unconscious will only illustrate one of them by putting you all into an incredibly deep sleep. Let's instead just talk about the high-level generalities of the two main causes of unconsciousness pertinent to the topic at hand. When someone is potentially dying, it's because of one of two things: traumatic injury or medical issue. Looking at the source of most Hollywood movie plotline unconsciousness trauma, the two main things that will make you become unresponsive are exsanguination, bleeding out, and traumatic brain injury. In the former case, if you were able to stay awake when bleeding to death, you simply would naturally. Slapping or shaking, not needed nor beneficial. Why? Well, anytime you're seriously injured, you're naturally going to have your sympathetic nervous system releasing epinephrine, norepinephrine, and dopamine. These hormones will do things like increase your heart rate and constrict your blood vessels and pupils. This results in the greatest amount of blood flow to your brain possible given the circumstances. Along with this, whether conscious or not, your baroreceptors also continue doing their thing, residing in an area of your carotid sinus, the beginning of your internal carotid artery, and in the arch of your aortic artery. These handy little mechanoreceptors sense a change in blood pressure and cause the body to react accordingly. Too high a pressure and it will inhibit your fight or flight nervous system, the sympathetic one. This allows acetylcholine, the main neurotransmitter for your rest and digest nervous system, the parasympathetic one, to slow down your body's heart rate and dilate its blood vessels, thereby decreasing your blood pressure. On the flip side, if they sense too little pressure, like when your precious blood volume is being spilled out onto the ground, it will stimulate your sympathetic nervous system to increase its heart rate and constrict blood vessels, raising your blood pressure. Thus, slapping the person in the face and telling them to stay away from the light will likely only see the medical professionals who arrive want to slap you in the face for potentially further injuring someone who is already barely clinging to life. That's not to mention that while you were doing that, you were not doing what you should have been doing, and that's applying direct pressure on the area of bleeding, which is easier and requires far less pressure than you might think to stop the bleeding, even for arterial bleeds. And it's also not like direct pressure is rocket science. It simply involves taking your hands, hopefully gloved or with some sort of barrier device to prevent the spread of disease, and then placing it directly over the wound. Then you simply apply enough force to stop the bleeding. Even in the worst types of bleeding, you won't need more than 3 to 4 pounds per square inch of pressure, or about 27 kilopascals. You should also have tried to immobilize any body part that looks out of place so as not to have its movement cause any more damage, thus shaking or slapping the individual in a vain attempt to keep them conscious for reasons is a bit counterproductive. Moving on, should the cause of unconsciousness be a traumatic brain injury, a TBI, like concussion or a bleed in the brain, slapping the person will at best do nothing and may well serve to make the injury worse. Further, shaking or slapping someone with a TBI also comes with the potential risk of damaging their spinal cord. Moving on to medical reasons for an altered level of consciousness, the causes are vast and can be difficult to nail down. There isn't always an obvious reason, like in trauma where you might see the bullet holes or the bones sticking out of the skin. In fact, there are so many that emergency medical providers use handy little acronyms like AEIOU-TIPS to make sure that they're thinking about all the potential causes when they're treating you. How does this acronym work? Well, A is things like alcohol and acidosis, E is things like epilepsy, electrolyte abnormalities, and encephalopathies. I is infection, infection being the number one cause of altered mental status in the elderly. O, things like overdose or oxygen deficiency. U is things like underdosing of medications or uremia. T is trauma or tumors. I is insulin problems, like in the case of diabetes. P is things like poisons or psychosis, and S is things like stroke or shock. In any of these cases, and so many more, the only thing forcing the person to stay awake will do is allow them to give a better history on what is potentially causing their problem. This can be incredibly helpful at speeding up optimal treatment, but it isn't specifically going to help reverse the actual issue as is usually depicted in cinema, nor is your shaking or slapping going to aid at keeping them conscious anyway. Just like in trauma, in all of these cases, the body already has compensatory mechanisms in place that will keep the person conscious if it can. In the end, knowing a person's body is already doing everything it can to stay away from the light, maybe instead of slapping them, just remember direct pressure, immobilization, call for emergency medical aid, and when all else fails, just lean down, smile, and say, "Look at me, we're gonna be okay, you can rest now." And maybe just throw in an "I love you 3000 just for good measure. You never know, it might just be your last chance to say it. So I really hope you found that video interesting. If you did, please do hit that thumbs up button below. Don't forget to subscribe. Also, check out Scott's podcast, Medical Confessions. Like I say, there's a link in the description below. And as always, thank you for watching.